to be saved. Another thing is to be blessed. I want to be both. I don't know about you. I want to be saved and blessed. What it means to be saved, very simply, and this is a word we use at the church, in churches, it means that we were doomed to be eternally separated from God because of our sins. But one day, God sent His Son, Jesus Christ, to planet Earth. And He was born just like a baby, like we've seen, a little baby who was born just as a child and lived among us with no sin. He gave many teachings. We have a compilation of His teachings in the New Testament. And He did something very special. He died at the cross. He died for you and me, paying the price for our redemption. Which means that we were reconciled in Jesus Christ with God. And all the wrath of God, all His anger because of the sins of the world was put upon His Son, Jesus Christ. So this is the reason why God doesn't destroy the planet. This is the reason why God doesn't destroy the human race. It's because he got really upset with us, but He decided to put all that anger upon His Son, Jesus Christ. So when Jesus died at the cross, He took upon Himself all that anger, the sins of the world, and He died bearing our sins. But death could not contain Him. So He resurrected. And after He resurrected, He ascended to heaven, where He is at the right hand of the Father, interceding for you and me. And He's waiting on us. So every time someone decides to surrender his or her life to Jesus Christ, something happens. Something happens in our spirit. We become born again. And we call this to be saved, salvation. Now, I would like to talk a little bit on this subject of salvation, and let's read in 2 Peter chapter 1, and we're going to start on verse 10, because some people have a misunderstanding of what it means to be saved. And it says on 2 Peter 1:10, "Therefore, brothers, be all the more diligent to make your calling and election sure." So we need to make our calling and our election sure. We need to have an assurance of our calling. "For if you practice these qualities, you will never fall. For in this day there will be richly provided for you an entrance into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ." Now, I would like to talk about this assurance that we have that we are saved. How many of you have been to an airport and they're waiting for a flight? Anyone here? Oh, it's the vast majority. So let me tell you what happens at the airport. We have passengers with a confirmed ticket, which is the vast majority. And then we have a few passengers that are trying to get a seat because either they've lost a transfer of their flight or there's some other reason they're trying to get a seat. And we see them very, very nervous by the counter. And once in a while, we have the agent calling their name and they go there with the passport and the credit card. And they're very, very anxious and very nervous, because they don't know if they're going to get on that plane or not. And I don't know if you've ever been in this situation. I've been in this situation once in the Toronto airport, and it was terrible because there was a flight and I was waiting. They were telling me, "Yes, you go on this one," and I lost that one. I said, "No, you have to wait for the next one and the next one and the next one." I was so upset. Thank God that I had a special Air Canada card that gave me access to the lounge, and over there I was able to talk with someone, and finally I was assured, "You're going on the next flight." Now, why am I mentioning this? Because also as Christians we have some people that are sure they have their ticket to heaven. They're sure, they're completely sure, but we have other people that, you know, they like God, they like Jesus, they like coming to church once in a while, but they're not sure of anything. They're in this situation, and usually it doesn't bother them, except when there's something really terrible happening in their lives. Like they go to the doctor, and the doctor says, "You have 3 months to live, or you're going to die soon, or your disease is going to progress." And then people get really anxious, and they start questioning, "Am I going to heaven? Am I not going to heaven? Am I saved? Am I lost?" Now, in Romans chapter 10, let's read Romans chapter 10. It says, Because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Isn't that good news?
Yes.
What you need to do? You need to confess with your
mouth.
And you need to believe in your
heart.
So when you do this, you are saved. So I don't know how many of you did this. If you didn't have the opportunity today, I'd like to give you the opportunity to confess with your mouth and believe with your heart that Jesus Christ is Lord. So this is the condition to be saved. It's not if you abstain from sin. It's not by your own works. It's not if you do good stuff. It's not by coming to church. But you need to believe in your heart that you can confess that Jesus is Lord. And then you're saved. And now this is where some people have a problem. Now in verse 10 it says, for with the heart one believes and is justified, and with the mouth one confesses and is saved. Now there is two doctrines in the Christian world. The first one, you can switch the slide, says that once you are saved, you're always saved. So this is one of the lines of thought that we have in Christianity. So you give your life to the Lord, you're saved. You're sealed by the Holy with the Holy Spirit. It doesn't matter what you do, you'll be always saved. Now we have another doctrine, and we're going to the next slide. I'm going to try to explain these two. And this one says that you can be saved and lost, and lost and saved, and you are saved, and then you commit a sin, and you're lost, and then you need to be resaved, and you need to you backslide, and you've lost your salvation, and now you need to be saved again and again. So I'm going to try to explain what I firmly believe and what should be a firm belief that we have as Christians. And I'm going to read one of the scriptures that used to confirm this doctrine that once you're saved always, forever. And I'm going also to mention the other scripture that says that you can lose your salvation. And then I'm going to bring everything to balance with the final scripture. So are you ready? Okay, so I don't know what you believe, but I'm going to explain what I believe. Alright, so let's go to the next verse, and let's try to find balance in our Christian life. There's something really important that is called eternal security. Eternal security. Eternal security, it's when you're convinced, when you know, that you know that you know that you're saved. Last week, I went visiting someone at the hospital. Actually, Pastor John and Stephen went there also. And we visited this man. It has been about maybe 15, 20 years. He doesn't step his foot on a church. He drinks too much. He's with a severe condition. He's almost dying. And he couldn't care less about God or the things of God. But when he was a child, he went to our church in Ganawagi, and right there as a child in Sunday school, he received the Lord Jesus Christ as Savior, and he knows he was saved. So when I went to the hospital, this man is lying in bed, possibly he's going to die soon, and he told me this, Pastor, I have Jesus Christ in my heart. I know that I'm saved. I know also that I've been a drunk, I've used the other substances, I did all sorts of wrong things, but I still believe in Jesus. And I said, amen, you're saved. And you know, it's not because of your sin that you lose the right of salvation. And I'm going to explain this a little bit further as we read this scripture in John chapter 10 and verse 27. Here's Jesus mentioning this aspect of salvation, and he said, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of the Father's hand. I and the Father are one. So this is the main scripture, and there's many, there's tons of scriptures in the Bible that show that once you are saved, nobody can snatch you out of the hand of the Father. So in this sense, in what this scripture says, it's once you are saved, you are saved. You become a child of God. Let me just give you this illustration. I have three kids also. And sometimes our kids misbehave. I don't know if it happens with your kids, but they do things that they shouldn't do. But they're still my children. They will always be. It's not that, you know, if Andrew, that is at the back there switching the slides, if Andrew does something wrong, I'll tell Andrew, Andrew Silveira, you're no longer a Silveira. I will not call you Silveira because you put your hand in the cookie jar. And I told you, you shouldn't. So from this moment on, you're not my child anymore. Does that make sense? It doesn't make sense. God is our Father. And when we give our lives to the Lord, we become His children. And yes, sometimes we do the wrong thing. Sometimes we fall, we commit sins, we're far away from God. We don't care about the things of God, but we're still His children. Can I hear an amen for this? We are still His children. Why? Because God is our Father. He accepted us. And it's not that because you've committed a sin that God is going to tell you, you're not my child anymore. Listen, there's two different aspects to them talking about one. One is to be saved, another one is to be blessed. I'm not talking about the blessings that follow salvation. I'm telling you about what it means to be saved. Once you are saved, nobody can snatch you out of the hand of God. God is not going to tell you, you've committed a sin, you've lusted, you stole this, you did this, you're not my child anymore. God is not going to do this. We have a loving God. We have a loving God. Now, we can be disobedient and be really far from the grace of God and from God's blessing. That's a different issue. But when you are saved, yes, you are saved. Be sure that you are saved. Yes, you can commit a crime, you can do something really awful. God is not pleased with you, but He's not going to say you're not my child anymore. Because God will never leave you, He will never forsake you. God loves you. And let me tell you, if you're here, and if you did, if you committed a sin, you did wrong things, let me tell you, God still loves you, you're still a child of God, you haven't lost your salvation, you are in God's hands, because God is greater than our sin. And there's no sin greater that cannot be forgiven by our Lord Jesus Christ. Can I hear an amen? Let's give an applause to the Lord. Praise God. Now, let me go further to explain this a little bit better. Because the relationship between Father and Son, it's sometimes very complicated. God is our Father, and He will allow us to make our own choices. So in life, you can choose to be in the Father's house, or do like the prodigal son that left the Father's house. But the Father never rejected the prodigal. In fact, He was there with arms wide open, and even smelling like pigs, He just embraced His Son, and He said, come to the Father's house. Because you see, it's not because of your sin that you will lose your salvation. You lose your salvation when you reject Jesus Christ. Yes. If you reject Jesus Christ, you lose your salvation. If you've accepted Jesus Christ and you commit a sin, you lose blessing. You lose fellowship. You can be cut of the fellowship. You can suffer tremendously, but God will never leave you. God will never forsake you. And the Holy Spirit will contend with you so that you'll come back to the Father's house. And that's a different issue. Someone asked me, what about suicide, Pastor? What happens if a Christian commits suicide? Because I heard they're going to hell. I don't know who told you this. Let me tell you, a person that commits suicide is not in their right mind. They're not reasoning well. They're not fully understanding what they're doing. And they commit a sin. Is God greater than our sin? Yes. Is Jesus Christ greater than our sin?
Yes.
Do we have an unjust God? I don't think so. If someone is saved and committed a sin, and he's out of his mind or her mind, and committed suicide, and did something really wrong, it's bad what they did, God is not going to send that person to hell. We have a loving God. God accepts you just as you are. It's not that God is pleased with your sin, but God will not bring your sins to remembrance. Everything is under the covering of the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. Now, I'm not endorsing that you go along and do wrong things or that you commit suicide. It's not what I'm saying. What I'm telling you is that once you are saved, if you have Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, even if you commit a terrible sin like the sin of suicide, God is not going to reject you. God is a loving God. There's a difference between being saved and being blessed. And I hope you'll understand what I'm saying. If you have questions, please feel free to ask questions at the end of the message or during the week. Now, let me bring it just now to a small portion of this message about losing your salvation. That yes, once you're saved, you're always saved. But there's an exception. See, what I believe, and after I've been preaching the gospel for many years, and I've been helping people with addictions for many years, and I've been dealing with the issues of sin and bringing people to the Lord for many years. And during the course of these years, when I went to Bible school, I remember teachers telling me, if you're in your car and you're listening to rock and roll music, the Lord will come one day, and if you're listening to rock and roll, you're going straight to hell. And I was, fearing and shaking, thinking, really? Really? And then I heard a singer, and there was a song in the 80s that was, why should the devil have all the good music? And I just love it. And I started to listen to other styles of music. And I learned, it's not the style of music that will send you to hell. It's not if you commit a sin that you go to hell. You go to hell if you reject Jesus. That's the unpardonable sin. Even the Lord said, and I mentioned this last week, all sin will be forgiven except blasphemy against the Holy Spirit. What is blasphemy against the Holy Spirit? It's to oppose the work of the Holy Spirit. What is the work of the Holy Spirit? It's to bring sinners to Christ. It's to convince with evidence that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. So if you reject Christ, yes, you're lost. But if you accept Jesus Christ, even if you commit a terrible sin, God is not going to put you to hell because God loves you. Now, here's the exception. Hebrews chapter 6 and verse 4. And here the scripture says, so do we believe once we're saved, we're always saved? Yes. I believe that, but with an asterisk, with a call, because there's an exception. And here's the exception. For it is impossible in the case of those who have once been enlightened, who have tasted the heavenly gift, and have shared in the Holy Spirit, and have tasted the goodness of the Word of God, and the powers of the age to come, verse 6, and then have fallen away to restore them again to repentance. Since they are crucifying once again the Son of God to their own harm and holding him up to contempt. So here's the exception. The exception is if a person, and listen, it's not any person. It's talking here about a mature Christian. Someone, as we can see on the previous verse, I'm going forward instead of going backwards. I cannot go backwards here. But where it says that once the person has tasted the Holy Spirit, the powers of the what is up to come, once the person experimented God and they reject what they reject the Son of God, this is what is being said here. On verse 5, once they have tasted the goodness of God and the powers of the age to come, verse 6, and have fallen away, it's impossible to be restored to repentance. So this is the exception to the rule. Yes, it is possible to lose salvation, but it's for a very specific group of people. And if you read on verse 7 now, it says, for land that has drunk the rain that often falls on it and produces a crop useful to those for whose sake is cultivated receives a blessing from God. But if it bears thorns and thistles, it is worthless and near to being cursed, and its end is to be burned. So what it's saying is there's a blessing coming, blessing it's rain. You like rain? Not today, okay? So, but in Scripture, rain is a blessing. And this blessing waters the good seed, but it also waters the weeds. So God is blessing people. And let me tell you, God blesses Christians, and God blesses people that are really far away from Him. Are you following me? And then finally, it ends on verse 9 saying, and this is the good news. You want to hear the good news?
Yes.
Verse 9 says, though we speak in this way, yet in your case, we feel sure of better things. So, what is Paul saying? Yes, It is possible for someone, a mature Christian, someone that preached the gospel, was baptized in the Holy Spirit, and intentionally decided to reject Jesus Christ as his Savior. That person is lost. But Paul says, this is not your case. Are you following me?
Yes.
This is not for everybody. This is not the normal thing that happens, that someone will come to Christ and then they abandon Christ. In fact, I try to remember how many people do I know that once were in a church and then they rejected Christ. Then out of the church I know lots. But it's not the church that saves you. It's Jesus Christ who saves you.
Amen.
This church cannot save you. Only Jesus Christ can save you. Because this church didn't die for you, but Jesus died for you. Amen? So it's not because you come to church that you're saved. But some Christians have this weird doctrine that they say, oh, you need to be holy and you need to come to church. If you don't come to church, you're lost. Oh, what happened to that person that used to come? Oh, they don't want to come to church anymore. Poor she, she's lost. No, she's not. No, she's not. The fact that you're away from the family doesn't mean that you don't carry the name of Christ in your life. The only way you can lose salvation is when you are a mature Christian and you say, I want nothing to do with Jesus Christ. If you don't want anything to do with church, you're still saved. But if you say, I don't want anything to do with Jesus Christ, there's a problem. Now let me tell you, some of you whose kids are not in church, were they saved in Sunday school? Praise God. They're not coming to church, but you know something is still inside. And I want to finish today by giving you an example. And I've asked two volunteers to come here to help me. And we're going to wrap up this very quickly. So can you bring that cross over here? And I'm going to just give you a visual example. The good news that I have for you is that we have a faithful God. How many of you like to have a faithful God?
Amen.
All right, so they're going to prepare themselves. I'm going to ask your help, bear with me just for a second. And I'm going to read a scripture in 2 Timothy chapter 2. 2 Timothy chapter 2, it's up there, so read it from the screen. It says, therefore, I endure everything for the sake of the elect, that they also may obtain the salvation that is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. How many of you want the salvation in Christ Jesus? So you are the elect. The saying is trustworthy, for if we have died with him, we will also live with him. Verse 12, if we endure, we will also reign with him. Now listen, if we deny him, he will also deny us. Verse 13, if we are faithless, he remains faithful. For he cannot deny himself. Now, here's the cross, and I am a sinner. And one day, I came to the Lord, and I gave my life to the Lord. And somehow, by some miracle that I couldn't understand at the time, I got tied to the Lord. Okay? So this is what it means to be saved. I was saved. So now I'm plugged to the Lord. I'm saved. Now I try my best to be faithful to the Lord. I don't know if you do the same thing. But you know what happens? Sometimes, you know, we start doing all the wrong things. And we get out of the light. And we start not coming to church, neglecting to read the Bible. But you know what? I'm still connected to the Lord, to salvation. But when I start to go further away from the things of God and from God, you know, I lose light, and then I start doing things. I start hurting people. I start going in my own way, and I start not knowing exactly where to go. And I really start hurting people. And as I hurt people, you know, I continue on my way, and I'm still going further away from God. And You know, don't be worried because I'm not going to hurt you. But I start hurting other people. Here's an elbow. And I go further away from God and further away. And here am I. And I start doing silly things. And as I start doing silly things, you know, the church is so far away now. But guess what? The Bible says He's always faithful. Even when I'm unfaithful, He will never leave me, and I'm still connected to Him. Amen. Aren't you glad that you have a great Savior? And I continue doing silly things, and I continue going on my way. And, you know, some people are saying, oh, he doesn't want anything to do with Jesus. He's far away from the Lord. He's lost. But I'm not. You see, I'm not. Because in the moment I gave my life to the Lord, I'm still connected. And at this point, I'm really, really, really far away from the cross. I'm far away from God. I'm going on my own way. I'm far away from the light. But the Bible says that our God is faithful. And one day, if I decide to come back to the Lord, you know, the Holy Spirit will always contend with me because there's something, there's a tie, there's a connection between me and God. Remember like that man that is in the hospital and said, I'm a drunk. I did a lot of wrong things, but I gave my life to the Lord when I was in Sunday school. Today I'm that man. And here am I. And the pastor goes to the hospital and tells the man, listen, it's about time you reconcile with your Father. Amen. See, God loves you. He never left you. You were always connected. And as you come now to the Lord, and you come close to the Lord, now you come again to the cross. Now you go to the cross, you repent. Now you're in the light again. Now you have God's blessing. Now you have God's favor. The closer you are to God, the closer He is to you. Even when you're unfaithful, He remains faithful. Praise God. Amen. Can we all stand? Thank you so much for this help. I hope this helped you to visualize what happens when someone gives his or her life to the Lord. God is a faithful God. One thing is to be saved. Another thing is to be blessed. I want to be both. I don't know about you. I want to be saved and I want to walk close to God. But if someone told you that because you're not coming to church or because you've committed a sin, that God rejected you, change church. Come to this one.